Okay, hi everyone. I'm Emmanuel Durand. I'm from the Society for Art and Technology, which is located in Montreal. And I will present you the Edition in situ platform, or in situ editing for in English, but we prefer saying it in French, because Quebec. So the Society for Art and Technology is a non-profit organization which aims at bringing tools to help artists create new media, new media shows, and in particular, we work a lot with immersive spaces. So we have a huge dome where the set is located, which is 18 meters diameter. And we have a few smaller ones to help artists prototype their content while the big dome is used. So usually artists are not pros regarding this kind of displays. It's their first time in such immersive spaces. And so they have to learn how to use it. We also have the tools to project inside non-dedicated immersive spaces, so we can project into virtually any kind of geometry, as long as we have the 3D model for the geometry. So this is just a room with white walls and projectors in the center. And on top of that, we also have telepresence tools. So we already did some shows which connected multiple domes together. In this case, it was two domes, one located in Montreal, the other one in Santa Fe, if I remember correctly. And so there was some video and audio transmitted between the two locations. And yeah, so a show was made with this. So the big question with this kind of immersive spaces is how do you create content for them? Usually, the artists use this very simplified workflow, which is they have a project idea, they do the initial creation on their workstation, and then they export it one way or another. Either they render it or they export it to use it in Unity, and they test it in the immersive space, so in our case, in our dome, and they check whether the result corresponds to what they had in mind, and they take notes, and they go back to their workstation. They fix things, and then they go back in the immersive space. And so they do a back and forth between the workstation and the immersive space until they are happy with the result. And then they can do the rendering or export it one final time for Unity, Unreal, whatever. So our goal to improve the creation workflow is to have an effective creation and edition of immersive environment. What we have observed is that, as I said earlier, there is a very steep learning curve for this kind of immersive spaces. Because, for example, in our full dome, which is very big, you don't it's a mono projection, you don't get stereo, but because it's very big, you can still get some sense of volume of of 3D in fact, but it's not it's really not immediate. It's you have to learn how to do your scenography, how you move your objects around your camera. And the thing is that as the artists have to go back and forth between their workstation and the dome, they can't get an immediate view of what they are doing. And on top of that, we have only one big dome, even though we have smaller ones. And so the time is limited. Each artist has a small amount of time inside the dome. So they have to get the results as fast as possible. So what this brings is that they are limited in what they can test inside the dome. So What we think finally is that if we were able to edit the content in situ, inside the immersive space, we could improve the creation speed. And we also think that it's no use to try converting every possible tool to in situ creation. And so we decided to limit our capabilities to just prototyping. Because, for example, a mouse and a keyboard will always be better for editing vertices individually than any kind of HTC Vive controllers or such type of controllers. So this is our hypothesis. Creation cycle from ideation to validation is shorter if the projection medium is also the work medium. In fact, this is what you get when you work for standard planar projection. You work on a screen, and when it's rendered and projected, it's also a big screen, in fact. And when you work the usual workflow for creating for full domes, you work on a planar display, you do your rendering, which is usually in spherical coordinates, and then you project. So you have a mismatch between the work medium and the projection medium. So what we really want is this kind of stuff. We want to be able to edit while inside the immersive space. And finally, the proposed workflow, what this would bring is that you start with your project idea, but it's instead of starting your work on your workstation, you prepare your assets and your storyboard or whatever, and you do the first pass in the immersive space. So you load the assets and the sound and whatever material you have inside the immersive space. You place them, you record quickly the animation, always prototyping, and you can have a first draft of what your piece will look like. And you can have a very, very quick view of what works, what doesn't work, and such things. And then you can go back to your workstation and use this draft as an example of what you should do, and you can improve on this. And we think that this allows to limit the number of back and forth between the dome and the workstation, and also that this way the artist can test more things. He has more time to test various configuration and animation and scenography. This is what we did with the AES platform. So the AES platform brings interaction metaphors in the way of virtual reality controllers and interactive audio visual rendering tools, which means video mapping tools and audio spatialization tools. So the platform is built on Blender with a few add-ons, Splash, which is our in-house video mapping engine, and Sati, which is our in-house audio spatialization engine. And for the hardware, we went for the cheaper yet very effective HTC Vive controllers, which we use through the VRPN protocol. I don't know if any of you are familiar with VR tools, but this is a standard. So we only use the HTC Vive controllers. So we have the headsets, which is somewhere in the dome. It's only a very big USB dongle for the controllers, and you need an immersive space. So a dome, a very big room with white walls and a few projectors, whatever. So I will make a very small demo of what this looks like in Blender. So this is an almost vanilla blender. So I have a few add-ons. I don't know if you can see very well, maybe not. A few add-ons loading into it. So we have an immersive viewport add-on, which allows for rendering the viewport of Blender in a spherical, equirectangular, or cube map mode. We have a SATI add-on, which communicates with our audio spatialization tool through OSC. And we have our live editing tool, which communicates with the HTC Vive controllers and allows for displaying in-situ menu to help selecting the right tool to do what you want. So if I load a known scene like the classroom, and there it is. So it's rendered in real time. It's the the classroom rendered in a rectangular. So it's a bit slow on my laptop, but on a desktop computer, it works quite well. And we are able to change it to spherical rendering. And it's really a viewport, so you can switch to wireframe. And it's really rendering the viewport in immersion. So it would be better if we were in a dome. So you have to trust me that it does indeed correspond to the real spherical projection. But yeah, that's it. And it works both with the Blender render viewport and the Cycles viewport. We have a few bugs regarding the lighting because it was not made for this, because we use a lot of off-screen rendering, but otherwise it works correctly. The other thing is that although this is indeed a viewport, you can't select anything in it because we didn't convert the mouse click to this kind of view. So if you click somewhere, it will do whatever. Okay, so otherwise, regarding SATI, what we can do with this is that you can connect to the audio spatialization engine, and then you can add sound to SATI. So I don't have the SATI engine running on my computer, but if I were, I would see all the sound sources, which are like samples or real-time generated sound. And so whenever I connect a sound to an object, if I move the object in the scene, it will move in real time in the dome. The sound will follow the object. So you can also prototype your audio spatialized sound. And yeah, in fact, this is also a very big thing for artists, because usually they don't know how to use correctly the audio setup in the dome, because we have a 31.4 audio system. And yeah. And so that's it. And the last thing is the menu. I can't show you the menu in real time because I don't have the controllers. And so I will only show you what this looks like. So we went for pie menus, which pop in the direction where you point the controller. And so yeah, you can do all these kind of actions, which are sculpting and painting. We didn't want to go for a full featured 3D modeling inside the dome, because once again, it's not the goal of the tool. The goal is to build scenography, not do 3D modeling. But sculpt and paint, they allow for creating like a landscape quickly. And so it makes sense in certain cases. We can also import object and sound. So you navigate inside a library of 3D models or the sound sources which are given by SETI, and you can import them, connect the sound to the object. You can translate, rotate, scale the assets that you have loaded. We also recreated the small gizmos that are purely informative. And you can navigate and animate. So for the animation, we implemented two systems. The first one is that you move through the timeline being the big window that you can see. So we are inside the big dome here. So you navigate through the timeline and you add keyframes whenever you want to, or you can make the timeline play automatically, and then whatever you move, a keyframe will be added. And this is almost like the easier to use, as we discovered. So now I will give you some very rough implementation details. So the immersive rendering is entirely done on in Python. There is no modification to the Blender code, and the rendering is called through a post-render callback, which is offered by the Blender API. We use bgl.gpu.offscreen to create the off-screen rendering for each direction of a QMap. And then with some OpenGL 3.3, we convert it to a spherical view or equirectangular or whatever. And as we wanted to use some modern OpenGL, we had to use PyOpenGL and not the OpenGL accessible through the Blender API. So this makes it work on Linux for sure, with NVIDIA drivers, but it doesn't necessarily work on other platforms. We only work on Linux at the SAT, in the research laboratory anyway. So we didn't test on any other platform, but yeah, this needs OpenGL 3.3 and has only been tested on Linux plus NVIDIA. Regarding the menus and gizmos, we didn't use Blender objects to create them. We built a small render engine on top of what Blender does, using PyOpenGL. And we had to modify the Blender code for this to work, because we were already using the post-render callback for the immersive view, and so we couldn't use the same post-render callbacks for the menus, because they were just drawn on top of everything else, and they had to be called once per cube map phase. So we added another post-render callback phase, which comes right before the immersive view. So we have our own fork of Blender with these small modifications, which is not a lot, but anyway. Also, this is more specific, but as we are in an immersive space and we don't use head tracking, because the interesting point in this kind of space is that you can have multiple users in it. So, typically, inside our dome, you can get 100 people at once. So you won't get 100 people editing stuff together, but anyway, it's not a single user device, and that's what's interesting about them compared to headsets. But the thing is, when you do the picking, if you do it the naive way, the picking will be done from the center of the dome, and you're not always at the center of the dome. You can be anywhere in the dome. So you have to correct for this. So the HTC Vive controllers you get the position inside a small space, and we use this to correct the direction of the picking. So in fact, we pick through a 3D model of the dome, and then we get the position of the picking direction on the surface of the dome to do another picking, which will pick inside the 3D scene. If you want some more detail, I can speak with you about this later. And this allows for using virtually any kind of immersive space. The picking will work in this kind of shapes or any other shape. So we build our platform, which gives us access virtually to any Blender capability, which is great because we didn't want to build a full-fledged editor from scratch. We don't need any export between the workstation and the immersive space. It's exactly the same file which is used all the way. And we can even run cycles in place. I didn't show it, but in cycles now you can render in a rectangular or spherical, and you can render directly inside the dome. So you can have the viewport, and then you choose an option inside the menu, and you have the cycles rendering. So that's good. On the other side, all this relies heavily on operators. And operators need a context to work correctly. This is some Blender API limit. And this implies that it's not possible to have multi-user, multiple user modifying the scene together. It's necessarily one user. So you can't either have networked multi-user. If you can't have multi-users in one space, it makes it hard to have them in multiple space. And also, the Blender viewport is not adapted for interactive pieces, obviously. It's not the Blender game engine. And we work with artists, and sometimes they want to do interactive pieces. So these are limitations from our first implementation. This platform is relatively new. It works since June, approximately. So we are still working with people to find some usages. So I'll show you two usages. The first one is with a researcher in history. And the second one is our own test, creating a film, although we are really not 3D creators. So it's what it is. So this is the first one. So the guy that you see here is an historian. He has never used an HTC Vive, or is even maybe even not a gamer. Really, he doesn't know this stuff. And so I showed him how to navigate inside the space. And yeah, this is one of our smaller dome, which does not cover the rear of the view, but the big dome was used this day. And so the project was about recording a sequence of him moving inside the 3D model of Paris in the 18th century. And later, this movement would be rendered with cycles and everything. But he was the one deciding where he would want to bring the viewer of the final film. So our platform allows for anybody to do some creation inside the virtual space, inside the immersive space. The other realization, it's a longer video, so maybe I will ask you to ask me questions if you have some. So we used our platform to create a short film to illustrate what we can do with it. And this is indeed the film that I posted in the submission to this conference. So this is what got me here. And so we tried to use all our tools. We had a few assets, 3D models, sound samples, and we created a film from scratch in approximately 2 hours, and inside the dome, and it was quite fun. Once again, we are not 3D artists, so it's not meant to be beautiful, or it's only meant to be informative and to show that this indeed works. So that's it. So we've used our platform in various contexts. We continue to work with it. And Blender was used to successfully help us build a first working version, because it brought us all the editing tools and the viewport and everything to build something without having to reinvent the wheel. But we can't go forward with using only Blender, so we will move to another platform for the immersive part. Once again, because we want to do multi-user, because the immersive spaces are built for multi-user. But anyway, we still want to keep Blender a central element of the workflow, because we are really fond of open source softwares. All our softwares, Splash and Stati, are also open source. And Blender is the right tool for the rendering part anyway. And yes, we want a better integration with the MetaLabs tool, because in the two examples that I showed you, there is no telepresence at all. And this is another reason why we want to use Python, because most of our library have Python wrapper. So thank you, and if you have any questions. Yes.
You showed us the immersive viewport.
Yeah.
Do you see like any implementation possible with the new EV viewport?
I hope so. I did not test. I tested Eevee, the development version. The only thing which would prevent it to be converted to Eevee is whether there will be an off-screen rendering API for Eevee. If there is, there is nothing limiting this. Yes.
Is it compatible with 3D projection systems? For example, a 3D projector with 3D glasses?
Yeah, so the question is, if I get it right, can we do stereo projection with this? Yeah, no, we can't, because, maybe we could, in fact. There is nothing preventing it, because what we do currently is that we do off-screen rendering of each face of a cube map, and then we reproject it into spherical view, or equirectangular, or such projections. So we would only have to do the same thing, but with two eyes. The thing is that when you work with headsets, doing the rendering in stereo is obvious, because the two eyes are always looking in the same direction. When you are in a dome, anybody can look in any direction at once. So you can't do this. You have to use some tricks, and usually the result is that you get stereo at the horizon, and you lose it when you look up or down. Yeah.
There is like now a new form of controlling like VR experience, like leap motion. Have you thought about it instead of like the HTC device?
Yes, we thought about multiple kind of controllers. And this is why we went for VRPN to connect to the HTC Vive controllers. We didn't want to be fixed on a controller. So right now we use the HTC Vive. It could be anything later. For example, we found that we were limited by the number of buttons on the HTC Vive. We really needed more buttons. So maybe we will try with the Oculus controllers. Leap motion, why not? Although I'm not a fan of just moving the fingers to do stuff. But yeah, why not? Okay. Thank you.